Didn't you tell the police that you talked to Pasha about taking possession of these drugs and the money, that you weren't going to be able to bring anything in until you got back from vacation? Didn't you tell the police that?
Nah, they asked me. They asked me for what I would do with.
Yes, and didn't you tell them?
Judge, I'm going to object because it's not really a fair way to question it. If you want to show him the statement, he can then recall whether he said that to the police. But to ask him to recall what was said to the police years ago is not a fair way to cross-examine.
Your Honor,
let me see the statement.
Thank you, Your Honor.
I understand the objection, Mr. Thompson. I think that's a fair question for cross-examination. If he doesn't understand the question and doesn't understand what Mr. Gilmore is asking him, he can certainly ask for clarification.
Well, if he doesn't recall, he would recall if he saw the statement. To ask him, did you tell the police something 2 years ago, Judge, is not a fair way to cross-examine.
Well, then he can say, I don't remember. I mean, at the question's appropriate, Mr. Gilmore, you can ask it, and Mr. Saunders can answer it if he can.
You've been here the whole time, right? The whole time we've been in trial, you've been
yes.
here every day. And you saw that we put a statement up on the video, on the screen, of you giving an interview with the police, didn't you?
Yes.
Right, and you saw that during that interview, you were asked a lot of questions and you said a lot of things during that interview, correct?
Yes.
One of the things you were asked about was what your plan was to do with the money, the weed, the tobacco that you got from Tasha Swain, wasn't it?
Yes.
Right, and when you were asked that by detectives, didn't you tell the detectives, well, you told Tasha that you couldn't do anything with it, you couldn't bring it into the prison until you got back from vacation?
I don't recall saying I told Tasha that I couldn't. That would continue to the prison.
When you were talking about with the text, how you were discussing with Tasha what she wanted you to do with it and you were thinking about it, you remember telling the police you were thinking about it, right?
I remember saying I was thinking about it. I never said, I don't recall saying that I told Tasha I was.
All right, but you remember telling the police that you were thinking about taking those items from the prison, don't you?
Yes.
And what you told the police was that you weren't going to be able to do it until you got back from your vacation, if you did it, correct?
Yes.
And didn't you also, well, did you know that when you were going to meet with Tasha on November 20th that she was going to bring you weed?
No.
You didn't know that? You're saying now that you didn't know that Tasha was going to bring you weed?
No.
Well, didn't you tell the police that you knew that she was?
No. I told the police, I said she brought me the weed, though, but that was only after I talked to Detective Engelhardt.
Didn't you tell Detective Engelhardt that Tasha gave you weed because you're going to give it to your friend?
Tasha gave you weed?
You got weed from Tasha so that you could give it to your friend.
I said I got weed to smoke with my friend.
So you're saying you got weed from her to smoke with your friend. Do you remember that you told the police that you got weed from her so that you could give it to your friend?
Judge, again, if the suggestion is that he said that to the police, fair thing to do is to show it to him and then ask him a question. Because you ask him a question about something that happened 2 years ago, then he shouldn't be expected to remember.
There is always redirect, Mr. Thompson.
My objection is the same as everybody else, Judge. It's an improper way to impeach him with a prior inconsistent statement. You ask him a question.
I respectfully, I don't know that it is, but I understand that you believe that it is. I don't know if there's anything we can point to that says in some cross-examination handbook that says this is how you cross-examine inmates. But if you want to clear up anything with Mr. Saunders on redirect, show him anything you think will refresh your recollections, so forth, that's perfectly permissible. But I think the line of questioning right now
tell the police that you were there to get weed for your friend and that Tasha said that she could help you with that?
I don't recall saying it.
All right, so you're saying your testimony today is you don't recall that you told the detectives that you were there to get weed from Tasha. Is that right?
I don't recall saying it.
And while we're talking about Tasha, I couldn't understand, I gotta be honest, how did you actually get to meet Tasha?
I met Tasha. My goddaughter was going to purchase hair from some girl. My goddaughter asked me to go with her. When we got to the place, the girl got out the truck. Goddaughter got out. I got out. While my goddaughter was talking to the girl about the hair, I stood over and I started talking to Tasha.
Okay. Well, you said earlier that you went to Walmart, right?
Yeah.
Did your goddaughter go to Walmart to get hair?
No, it was in the parking lot.
So your daughter was going to Walmart, your goddaughter was going to Walmart parking lot to get hair?
No, we was meeting them at Walmart.
Was the hair going to be there at Walmart? At the parking lot?
No, the girl had the hair with her.
So your goddaughter wanted to take you. Are you the person that helps your goddaughter with hair?
No.
But she wanted to bring you to go get her hair.
She wanted to bring me to make sure that nothing went wrong.
She went to a Walmart parking lot, right? So your goddaughter was worried that when she was in the Walmart parking lot, the person that she was buying hair from was going to rob her or assault her? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, she wanted to make sure nothing happened when she was purchasing the hair.
Has she ever purchased hair from this person before?
No.
Okay, so she wanted to, rather than go to a store or a salon, she wanted to bring you to the Walmart parking lot to purchase hair from somebody that she's never bought it before. That's what you're saying.
I'm saying that she went to Walmart. The girl was selling hair.
Wait. So did you know that there was going to be somebody selling hair at Walmart before?
We met at Walmart. Park.
Who met? Who's this? So there's somebody that had just set up shop in the Walmart parking lot selling hair, and you were taking your goddaughter because she was afraid that that person was going to rob her?
Back then, whether it was Facebook, Instagram, some social media site, they would sit up here, different people would sit up here and sell hair. It's what you call Brazilian hair. They sit up here and sell hair. They would put ads, like I said, on some type of social media. My goddaughter, she must have sat here and talked to this person or whatever, set up a meet.
A meet to purchase hair.
Meet to purchase hair.
Okay. And you're saying that this sort of risky, dangerous purchasing of hair, when you got there, Tasha Swain was with the hair seller?
They came together. They was together.
Were they in the same car?
Yes, they were in the truck.
Alright, so you're saying that Tasha is in the hair business then?
I know the girl who she was with was selling the hair.
Do you know the girl that she was with? Do you know her name?
No, I don't know her name.
Right, of course you don't know her name.
Objection.
You're on all the time.
The jury can disregard the comment.
And when you got there, did you strike up a conversation with Tasha? Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay. And before I, what's your goddaughter's name?
Shanice.
Shanice. And so when you're there, you see Tasha, you struck up a conversation. Was this, you were flirting with her?
We just sitting there and just talking. You could call her.
All right. So you're flirting with Tasha, and you asked her for a phone number?
Yes.
And at that time, did you tell her that you were living with somebody?
Not at that time.
All right. And so you got a live-in girlfriend, though, and you chat up Tasha Swain, and she gave you a phone number then?
Yes.
Were you were clear with her that your intentions were romantic?
At that time when we were at the parking lot?
Yeah, when you asked her for a phone number. Did you say, I want to take you out sometime?
No, not at that time.
What was your reason for getting her phone number?
Reason why I got her phone number is that we sat here and I asked her that if, like I said, if I wanted to get some hair for myself, you know, I'm bald here. I said, I want to get some hair for myself. That means I asked hair for myself, whatever. I said, could I call you and get the hair for
right. you? Okay, but you said you didn't know she was in the hair business, so this is just your pickup line, correct?
I guess.
All right, and did you hide the fact that you were flirting with her?
However, she took it.
Do you know where Tasha Swain lives?
At that time?
Yeah, at that time, did you know where she lived?
No.
Right, and you didn't know where she lived when you were interviewed by the police on November 20th, either, did you? Chatted up, and by November 20th, you had called 503 times, but on November 20th, you didn't know where she lived, correct?
No. I think my dad, I think I know where she lived. I think I said Tom's birth.
And again, you had an opportunity to watch your interview played in the courtroom, correct?
Yes.
Right. Would it surprise you to learn that when they asked you where she lived, you said, but like I said, I know that she lives in Lakewood.
I said Lakewood.
Yes, that's what you said. We can play the audio for you if you'd like. Well, that's me reading from the transcript. I don't want to promise that I can play you the audio right now. And you also didn't really know what her name was either, did you? On November 20th.
Tish.
Tish. That's not her name, is it?
That's not her name.
Right. And you didn't seem to know which one was which, Tish or Tasha. Did you? Maybe she didn't want to tell you her real name. You think that's possible?
No.
No? Well, she didn't ever call you once, did she?
No.
She never called you one time, did she?
No.
And you called her 503 times, and she did not call you once, correct? And you've never been to her house, have you?
No.
And you testified before that you went with Tasha to lunch a few times?
Yes.
And you didn't know her
she said, no. I said, what's your name? And she said it again. But the way she said it, I thought she said it again. She said, no.
So when you're talking to detectives, you're thinking back to your flirting game with Tasha Swain. That's why you said Tisha.
That's why I said Tisha.
And you said that you went to lunch with her a few times. You also said that she talked to you about some pretty personal things, right?
Yes.
So she talked to you about her daughter being the victim of domestic abuse, right?
Yeah.
It's pretty personal, correct?
Yes.
That's a pretty personal thing to talk to. And she also talked to you about an issue that her friend had, and you said you gave her money to help with that. And in all of that time, in all the 503 phone calls, the months that you knew her, you learned about her daughter, she never one time said that her husband was Lacovian Shepherd?
No.
So she knew, you knew about her daughter and her abuse, but you didn't know that she had been with a man for over 20 years? And you said that she told you in your interview that she had a, first she said a cousin and then a brother at Southwood State Prison. Is that right? Did Tasha tell you that?
Yeah, she said somebody, yeah. She told me it was a brother at Southwood State Prison.
And so she told you her brother was at Southwood, but she didn't tell you her husband again. She is the mother of his children, that her husband was at Southwood State. And you had said that you told her that you were a corrections officer, is that correct?
Yes.
At Southern State?
Yes.
And that never came up that her husband was at Southern State?
No.
And these conversations, these personal conversations with Tasha about her daughter, was that all during like these 1 minute phone calls?
No.
Well, you didn't really talk to her on the phone for more than 3 minutes very often, did you?
No, I talked to her. I talked to her for quite a while.
Okay. Did you put up S11?
Right. So, did you mean numbers of conversations or length of conversations? You said talk for a while.
Let's just pick a day here. This is S11, so let's talk about November 20th, and this is somebody that you are very friendly with, you said. Talk about her daughter. Looking at November 20th, the day that you were arrested, it says 1326 to 1326. How long a conversation does that look like to you?
That's a minute.
Right, and the next one is 1402 to 1402, correct?
Mm-hmm.
So the next one is 1844 to 1844, correct?
John, sorry. He's in the way.
Oh, I'm sorry. The next call is 1844 to 1844?
Yeah.
And then 1913 to 1914?
Yeah.
And 2041 to 2041?
Yeah.
2110 to 2111, is that correct?
Yeah.
So you called her six times on November 20th, right? Not four, but six times. And all of these calls are under 2 minutes, correct?
You know, I'm going to object. I think there needs to be more foundation with regard to this particular line of questioning. For example, you called him. Did you get her when you called? If he didn't get her, it would explain why I called him so short. There needs to be more foundation. For example, to ask him if he made contact with her every time he called.
Well, now that you've heard that, Mr. Summers, you want to answer that question differently?
Okay.
Sure, go ahead.
Can you put back up the...
Is that your plan? Sure.
On the 20th?
Yes.
Was that the first one? Was that 13? Can you make a bigger like you first had? Thirteen, 20,
Saunders, do you remember that, of all the calls that you've made, just specifically remember the nature of the call me back at a certain time?
Yeah.
Back up for November 20th, 2017?
Yeah, I remember when I called it. Remember when I had called it, you
know. Okay.
All right, so on November 20th, though, none of those calls were over 2 minutes, correct?
Yeah, for it is none of those over 2 minutes.
And you were here when the analyst from the Department of Corrections testified, right?
Yes.
She said that these calls, out of all of them, they generally all were 3 minutes or less. Do you recall her saying that?
Not maybe.
And by the way, on November 20th, you said you were with Mara Hudson?
Yes.
So what was she doing when you were calling Tasha Swain 6 times on November 20th?
The first time I had called Tasha, me and Mara, we already had run our separate ways. We already had finished.
So you finished lunch with Tamara and then you started calling Tasha?
Yeah.
And called her 6 times? You testified earlier, and you heard the testimony, you testified earlier that you, I can't remember if you call it acclimatization or orientation to when inmates would come on Unit 6.
Orientation.
Right, and was that just you, your system?
No, just mine.
Right, so other guards didn't necessarily do the same.
I have no idea what the guards did.
But that orientation did, that wasn't a rule or regulation that you were following to do that, was it?
No.
That was on your own accord?
Yes.
And on your own accord, you talked about inmates not being rats or snitches, correct?
That makes sense. Yes, I did say those words.
Right, and you said that in your interview with the detectives, right?
Yes.
And you saw Lacovian and John Small also both said essentially the same thing. You would tell all new inmates no rats or snitches on your unit, correct?
Yes.
And you had said something about you didn't want anybody to rat or snitch because that would lead to the beds getting turned down?
Turned over. Yes.
As a corrections officer that is supposed to make sure there's no contraband in the prison, why would you have a problem with the beds getting turned over?
The problem wasn't the fact that the beds getting turned over. The problem was if an inmate sat there and had a problem with another inmate. And he would sit up there and he would drop a note, what we call the note. And that note, he would drop in the mailbox or he would go to the medical box up in the center, drop a note in there. And then from there, once whoever entered the mailbox, they would turn over to what we call our center. That's where our lieutenants and supervisor was at. And then from there, they would sit here, they would come there and come to the unit and see what the problem is. Now, it all depends on the severity of the note of what they would drop as far as what they would come to.
Is it a bad thing if supervisors find out there's a problem on your unit?
It depends what the problem is. If it's a legitimate problem. Now, as far as a problem being like, If an inmate was to drop a note saying that John Smith.
Sir, I'm going to ask at this point, it's not responsive to the question.
Judge, it seems to be, to me, Judge, maybe you didn't understand it. Rephrase it.
Well, the question, I believe, was, is it a problem if, well, you rephrase, I mean, you could say it again, so I don't remember specifically the words, but is it a problem if there's an issue on the unit or something like that.
Right. My question to you is, if an inmate has information about contraband or something that's going on in the unit, why would it be a bad thing for supervisors to find out about that?
No, that wouldn't be a bad thing.
Well, why would you tell them not to rat or snitch them?
No, I say if you drop a note, because if you have a problem with a person, and you just want them off that unit. That's the difference as far as I'm saying a rat or a snitch or whatever the case may be, how they talk. you have a problem with that person. I'm not saying that it's a problem if, okay, you sit up here and there's actual drugs on you, or you drop a slip or he even comes out, whatever. That's not a problem.
Right, because they told you it was him there, right? Because if you knew that they knew about drugs and you didn't want anybody else to know, correct?
No.
You didn't want your supervisor to find out that you had given somebody drugs or tobacco, correct?
Why would I give somebody drugs or tobacco?
Because they're paying you money.
Who's paying you money?
The inmates are.
Judge, is there a question here? This sounds like a discussion, or an
event. It seemed like a question, but I don't know if it's the way
Mr. Saunders is asking him questions.